Hi, my name's Dr. Sam Marks, and I'm the TEM Product Manager for Oxford Instruments. Today in this tutorial, I'll be going through an introduction to energy dispersive spectrometry and how that's applied inside the transmission electron microscope. In today's presentation, I'll pick up where I left off on my previous tutorial and start looking at TEM as a technique compared to SEM. I'll highlight some of the similarities and differences between the two different electron microscopes, and then we'll move on to focusing on TEM, looking at the difference between TEM and STEM. And moving beyond that, we'll talk about how we can optimize our TEM acquisition, look at TEM quantification using the Clif-Lorimer approach, and then finally touch on our advanced TEM quantification routine known as M squared T. I won't be touching much on the basics of electron microscopes and EDS analysis as we went through that in the previous tutorial. But just as a quick recap, electron microscopes are very similar to light microscopes. As you can see from this diagram here, in an SEM, we are using an electron source instead of light, so we are accelerating electrons from maybe a tungsten filament or a field emission gun. Those electrons are then accelerated down the column and they're focused, so just like in a light microscope, but not using a glass lens. In an electron microscope, we use an electromagnetic lens, and eventually they come all the way down the column and they interact with your sample. And this is where our first key differential comes in. In an SEM, it interacts with a bulk sample, and we look at what signal gets bounced back away from that material. Whereas in a TEM, we are looking at electron transparent samples, and that's looking at the electrons that pass through a sample and capturing any interactions that occur. So TEM versus SEM. What's the same? What's different? What does it mean? So a key misconception is that EDS data from an SEM will look very similar to EDS data from a TEM. And though the technique is the same, this typically isn't true. A scanning electron microscope, an SEM, is a surface or maybe a subsurface analysis technique that looks at bulk samples. So we have an accelerating voltage of about 0.1 to 30 kV, and the size of samples that we'll be looking at, the features of interest, are probably going to be in the micron range, down to the nanoscale, but not typically anything smaller than 50 nanometers. Now, if we compare that to a TEM, a transmission electron microscope, so you can see in the ray diagrams here, they look very similar. It just looks like a TEM is bigger, which is true. It's at least twice the size. And looking at the similar kind of characteristics, so our samples, so we're looking for electron transparent samples. That means our samples have to be less than 100 nanometers thick. If we're comparing accelerating voltages, a TEM will typically operate at 60 kV up to 300 kV, with the biggest machines in the world being over 1 million kV. And for features of interest, we're now talking nanometers. Most TEM samples will typically be looking at features that are kind of sub 100 nanometers, all the way down to angstroms and atomic resolution. So kind of in summary, we could say that SEM is a bulk surface analysis technique. And a good comparison that we can make is talking about and looking at a semiconductor device, a chip, an electronic circuit board that you'd find if you pull apart any old TV remote. And that's what you can see here. Lots of components. We've got a 250 micrometer scale bar, and the EDS is telling us what these components are made of in a bulk sense. Now let's compare that to a TEM sample. So TEM is a very site-specific analysis technique. And what you can see here is a semiconductor device. And this is basically a fib lift out of a very precise section of a semiconductor device, just like what we're seeing on the left-hand side. The difference is the scale. So as you can see, our scale bar is now 100 nanometers compared to 250 micrometers. And we're seeing very fine structures with components here that are less than 10 nanometers in size. And as I described in my previous tutorial, because of interaction volume and the resolution of the microscope, this level of detail and analysis would be extremely challenging, if not impossible, to be achieved using a standard SEM approach. TEM versus STEM. What's the difference and what do these acronyms mean? So what is a TEM? As you can see here from this beautiful ray diagram, this is a TEM operating in TEM mode. Now that might sound a bit stupid, but what we want to do is look at this blown up section here, because that's all that really matters. And what you can see is we have a green line, which is where our sample sits. And you can see a parallel illumination passing through that sample plane. This means that we have an even distribution of electrons passing across the sample at the same time. And this is a bit of a challenge because when we're doing EDS, we like to know where our X-rays are being generated from. And if you're illuminating the whole of a sample, it's quite hard to actually locate that. And what do I mean by this? So this is a very exaggerated example, but what you can see here is a pretty common image if you've done TEM. This is what a fib lift out looks like if you're in low mag mode. So in the center of the phosphor screen there, you can see a little lift out. That is the area of interest sat on a nice big copper fib grid. And in this scenario, we're interacting with the sample with electrons and therefore we're generating X-rays. So if we clicked acquire on our EDS detector, what we would see is a copper signal that's probably 95 to 98% of the spectrum would be pure copper. And we would see some real trace elements coming from the actual sample, because the electrons are passing through everything that you can see. They're not being focused on a specific area of interest. So how can we deal with this in TEM mode? Well, the most obvious answer is we focus the beam down to a spot. And this does work. Once you focus the beam down, you are only passing electrons through that central spot. And as long as you know where that is and what it's interacting with, you are performing EDX on that region. The problem is we've now focused our beam down to a spot and we might have accidentally gone off the sample. We may be a few nanometers to the right, which when we're looking at performing quantitative analysis isn't going to help us and it's not going to be great. The other issue that we have is if we're really trying to focus the beam onto a very small sample or a small fine region, a lot of the time as you go to high magnification, you really need to have a good TEM alignment to focus your probe down to that spot, and that can be quite hard to achieve. So TEM, basically, it's not really suitable for EDS. It's not the optimum analysis technique. So what should we use instead? And the answer to that is STEM, Scanning Transmission Electron Microscopy. So here again, we have a rather complex ray diagram, but zooming in at the area of interest, we can see that now at the sample plane, we no longer have a parallel beam that's going through the sample. We have a very nice fine probe. And as I showed in the previous tutorial, this is significantly better for EDS as it gives us control of the electron spot and allows us to perform much more advanced analysis like mapping and line scanning. So STEM is significantly better for EDS. And what do I mean by this? Well, here's just a basic example. So we have that semiconductor device that we showed previously. And This just looks like a nice colorful image, but it's actually a lot more than that. So this is a spectral image, which means that for each pixel in that image, we have an associated EDS spectrum. From this, we can extract data. So the example you can see here, we've extracted spectrum 17 from this area, and that pulls out all of the EDS data from within that region and gives us a spectrum to show what elements are present there and allows us to really assess and interrogate our data. So that covers the basics of TEM versus STEM and a kind of introduction. So how can we optimize our TEM analysis? So the first thing to be aware of is just how complex the interaction between the electron beam and your TEM sample is. So we're in a really confined space, and one big challenge for TEM is minimizing spectral artifacts. So with all of these components in close proximity, like the anti-contaminator, the pole piece, the specimen holder itself, we can often get x-rays that we're not wanting. And the first thing is being aware of these x-rays, and the second is looking at ways to kind of minimize these artifacts. And often the most easy way to reduce them is just tilting the sample holder, and we'll kind of look into that next. So TEM sample holders. Choosing an appropriate sample holder is really quite important for your analysis. So a standard TEM holder, it's great to use, it's very robust, but it is not optimized for EDS analysis. And a good example of this can be seen here. So on a standard TEM holder, you have your copper grid and it's sat in a nice cup. And as you can see, it's in a nice well. And what that means is that any x-rays that are being generated at the sample and then moving towards the EDS detector on the right, some of them may have to pass through the TEM sample holder. And what you're seeing here is if our x-rays from our sample have to collide with the TEM holder, then that can result in spurious x-rays being generated and then being transmitted into the EDS detector. And this is why we often see characteristic x-rays of iron, cobalt, copper, because they're actually fluorescence being generated from your sample and x-rays going through the holder into your detector. Now the easiest way to minimize this fluorescence and these background counts is to use a low background TEM holder. What this is typically it's a TEM holder that's made out of beryllium, and it's also been cut away and shaped to try and minimize the amount of shadowing and reduce the amount of x-ray fluorescence, which gives us a cleaner spectrum but also can help improve our solid angle. So solid angle is a measure of the number of x-rays that we're capturing inside our microscope. And in TEM, because of these geometries and the really restricted working space, often the best solid angle isn't achieved until you tilt your sample holder. And that's what you can see here in this little GIF. So we have our sample holder in the center of the TEM, and because of its shape, it actually shadows part of the detector when you're at zero tilt. So to optimize our solid angle and to maximize it, you typically want to be tilting your sample to plus 20 degrees, as that allows us the greatest exposure of the SDD and optimizes our x-ray collection. So you can see these effects in real world here, where we've got a collection of spectra that have been acquired at different sample tilts, 0 to 20 degrees. And there's some really interesting things you can see in this spectrum, because this is a 15 kV spectrum, and one of the peaks of interest is nickel. And at the nickel K line at 7 kV, we see the similar intensities no matter what the tilt is. This is because the nickel K energies are strong enough, or they're large enough, to transmit through the sample holder and make it to the EDS detector. However, if we look at these low energy lines, we can see that the 0 degree baseline, which is our yellow spectrum, compared to the 20 degree tilted spectrum, which is our green line, there's some significant differences. And this is a direct visualization of absorption. So these low energy X-rays, they're hitting the edge of the sample holder and they don't have enough energy to penetrate through. They're being absorbed by the sample holder and they're creating more stray peaks, which are then going into the EDS. So when we're tilting our sample holder to 20 degrees, we're improving the line of sight between the detector, we're reducing the amount of absorption and fluorescence, and we're optimizing our EDS analysis. So I touched on absorption there, which is where X-rays are being generated, but before they make it to an EDS detector, they are being blocked and absorbed by another material, because an X-ray at the end of the day is just a packet of energy. And this can play a big difference to fixed samples, and users should be aware of this when they're mounting the orientations of their samples, to look at the line of sights between the area of interest and the EDS detector. Take this example here on the screen. We've got quite a chunky sample. It's a wedge, so it's thin at one side and thick at the other. If our EDS detector is positioned on the left-hand side, at the thinner side, then our X-rays only pass through a very small amount of material before having a free line of sight between the EDS detector and their generation. This means that there won't be too much absorption because the X-rays are pretty clear when they're generated and then go straight to the EDS detector. Whereas if we look at the case with the EDS detector on the right, the line of sight between the EDS detector and the sample is filled with actual material. So any X-rays which are being generated, they need to pass through quite a large absorption region before they're free to pass through vacuum and go to the EDS detector. This means there's a greater chance of low energy X-rays being absorbed during this period, which is going to affect the quality of your EDS results, especially those low energy X-ray lines. This is why you should always take care to orientate your sample to minimize the amount of material between the specimen and the detector, be this the sample holder or grids, copper grids on your sample from your fib lift outs and or the kind of drop cast bars. Quantitative analysis in the TEM. So I just wanted to briefly touch on TEM quant, how it's performed and what you should be aware of to really get the best out of your quant results. In the TEM, we use the Clif-Lorimer quantification routine. And this is quite a good approach because as long as we make some assumptions about the thickness of our sample, it's relatively simple quant. As you can see from this equation here, it relates the quantities of two elements, CA and CB, to the intensity of their X-ray lines. And all of that is linked to a K factor. Now, the good thing about TEM EDS is that these K factors are very well established, and we provide a full database of K factors, so you don't really need to worry what those values are. If you're an advanced user, you can do some experiments and set your own, but we have a really good understanding and a full dictionary of elements available. And like I said, this quantification routine, the good thing about it is that if we assume our sample is very thin and that absorption effects and fluorescent effects are negligible because of this thickness, then we get a really good quant and we get a really good representation of the weight percent or the atomic percent of your material. However, in TEM, most samples aren't completely thin. So that Clif-Lorimer approximation it's really talking sub 10 nanometers. And in the TEM, we can be looking at samples that are about 100 nanometers. And this affects our quantification. And that's what you can see here. So we have two spectra, and we can use the Clif-Lorimer approach to generate a theoretical spectrum. And that's what this pink line is. However, if we put a thickness of zero and don't put a density in, then you can see that the background isn't correct. The peaks aren't exactly at the right height. And that's because at the end of the day, your sample isn't truly electron transparent and completely thin. There will be some thickness. There will be some density. And the big question is, how can we measure that to get truly accurate absorption corrected TEM? And that's what our M squared T advanced TEM quant is. So this approach to quantification uses a standard sample to calibrate your electron microscope. From this sample with a known mass thickness value, we can then look at raw EDS and actually calculate the mass thickness value of your sample. So how does this work? It's relatively straightforward. We put in our calibration sample, which is a silicon nitride thin film. We perform EDS on it. We then swap it out and put in our unknown sample, and we perform EDS. And then this automatically applies our correction and gives us a more accurate EDS TEM quant that is absorption corrected, and also gives us a mass thickness value for that sample, in which case we can then input the density and we get a direct measurement of the sample thickness out. So measuring sample thicknesses in TEM is a really useful technique. The only other way to do it, there's two typical routes, is looking at the ADF image and calibrating against your Z contrast and looking at EELs. And looking at the data here, we've got a fib wedge which is of a varying thickness, and we've performed ADF thickness measurements, EELs measurements, and EDS measurements, and we've looked at this data across the top of the sample. And as you can see, our EDS data sits right in the middle and follows trends perfectly with the EELs data and also the ADF. So this means that we can get a really good thickness measurement out of our sample for that true kind of advanced TEM quant. Thank you for listening. I hope you found this useful. I'll now be around for any questions. And if you would like to look at my previous tutorial, that goes into much more detail about the basics of EDS, how an EDS detector works, and how we generate these spectral images and perform peak deconvolutions. Thank you.